This is essentially the new insurance landscape. Jason, do you want to talk about this slide?
So as Michael is alluding to, we really feel that the public exchanges, which in Texas is actually the federal exchange, and the state exchanges throughout the country, are really going to lose momentum, and they're going to see participation decrease for a couple of reasons. To give a quick example of Texas, and I think Michael talked about it, is going to expand on it, is in Texas, Blue Cross Blue Shield, which is the big bear in our marketplace, at least on the individual small group world, they drive the market share here. They got out of the individual business. I know we're not talking about individual business, but this is going to give you an example. They got out of the individual business, got rid of their largest network, their PPO network, as of January 1st, 2016. So they lost about $400 million just on their individual programs in Texas because that they no longer could do individual underwriting in the individual market. They were forced to take on the good risk and the bad risk. And if someone asked me what care to go to on the individual market, I would always tell them Blue Cross got the most expansive network. They had the best variety of plans, had the best price points in most situations here in Texas. So that kind of gives you an example that now they exited out and they're no longer offering their large network on the individual side. They offer an HMO network. Texas HMOs really aren't that strong, but their HMO network is very, very, it's called the Blue Advantage, and it's very disadvantaged. They give about 15% overlap of their primary care and regular doctors in their HMO network and about 50% of the hospitals. So you're talking about this very expansive large network here in Texas now shrunk down to very small network. And so we believe that's going to be a constant trend in the public exchanges, the federal exchange, the state exchanges, and cares are going to go to these more leaner networks, maybe not as extreme as Blue Cross, so to speak, on here in Texas that they went to in the individual market. And because of that, there's going to be a bigger growth or opportunities in the private exchanges. So here's some examples of the segments. About in 2000 or 2011, there's about 170 million on the employer-sponsored insurance, and that's going to go to about 150. Where you're going to see the biggest growth is, and this is based on the aging population of people approaching Medicare, is going to be about 118 million on Medicare, Medicaid, government programs today, or in 2011 is 86 million. So this is going to be a shift where you're going to see a widespread of people are going to get out of the exchange business or the federal exchange, state exchanges. The employers are going to want to go to more widespread choices for employees, talking about shifting that pendulum down to employee engagement, employer contribution versus defined benefit programs that we have today.
Get 49 million uninsured, and then with widespread, 32 million uninsured. I mean, the whole reason for this ACA thing, right, was to get rid of all the uninsured, make sure everybody had insurance. You're still showing 32 million uninsured people in 2021.
Yeah, based on the study, but one thing to keep in mind is that there's going to be some constant shifts to the program today, the Affordable Care Act as we know it. We've got some upcoming elections, later this year. So we're not going to see a whole lot of shifts. We'll see some minor shifts up until about June, and then I think everything's going to be on pause. So we'll see what happens. But a lot of the shifts also going to be that you have the baby boomers are aging into Medicare and some government programs. Now, how sustainable those are going to be from a long-term basis, and will they be around to the tune that we have it today by 2021, we don't know. So this was obviously a projection, but it kind of just talks about the wide changing landscape of where we were a few years ago, pre-Affordable Care Act, and to where we are today and going. So, but good point.
I think it's important to understand that really what the Affordable Care Act did or was that it was insurance reform. It really wasn't, I think I was talking, who was that? Chris? Right. I was talking with Chris. You didn't wake up January 1, 2014, go to the doctor, and your doctor didn't perform anything differently with you because of the ACA being implemented. All it is just it's an insurance reform process. What they probably should have done was expanded Medicare and Medicaid, and that may have done essentially the same thing as what this essentially was trying to accomplish. But really, it's a fresh start, rise of the consumer. We talked a little bit about how we think millennials are going to affect healthcare and how you need to deliver healthcare to your employees. So let's take a fresh look at employees as consumers, okay? So common perceptions. Our employees won't understand. They don't have internet access. It only takes 2 minutes to make their selection, and they rely on me to assist them. So CFOs, HR people, mostly from the HR perspective, we've got to get out of coddling your employees. It's like the 401k. You provide them a 401k, but you really don't provide them any guidance. You don't say, hey, you should put your money in this S&P 500 fund, or you should put your money in this bond or index fund. They make choices based upon how they feel they want to direct their retirement, or are they risk averse, or are they, you know, all in going with, you know, buying, you know, an S&P 500 fund or a tech fund or et cetera. So why would you do that with their medical plan? This gives them an opportunity to essentially choose from one of six or one of seven or one of eight medical plans that best suits their needs. So the new reality is that your employees are regularly making complex business decisions and buying decisions online. They have access to technology, smartphones, social networks, Facebook, et cetera. They're using Netflix, Amazon, online banking. So let them engage in the process, and hopefully that engagement in the process will drive down your bottom line and drive down your cost of your entire benefits platform. Just an interesting statistic, rise of the consumer. These are all the items: life insurance, car insurance, downloadable music, clothing, books. People buy a lot of stuff online, and by engaging people in an online process and actively engaging them, the goal is to obviously try to reduce your cost. So just like Amazon, just like eBay, just like all those online processes drove down the price of product, the hope is that these exchanges can hopefully drive down not only the cost of the health insurance for the individual, but also the cost of the health insurance for the employer.
Yeah, I was just going to add, so their study showed, I think it was a 40 to 70 hours on average a family spends on Amazon a year, and they spend about $2,500. On the flip side, a family that spends about $7,000 to $10,000 on insurance needs, you know, health, dental, life, disability, spends about 25 minutes a year in that selection process. So we believe that we got to put more time and effort in for the employees to be able to be engaged. There's decision-making tools, so if someone wants to just, you know, pick the flavor of chili, they can pick the flavor of chili, and the system will kind of give them the recommendation of what plans to select. Or the person that's the you know, student of the insurance and wants to pick the right plan for their family, really evaluate every line, they've got the ability to go online and figure that out through call center capabilities as well, if they want to talk to someone live to talk through that process. Doesn't mean you get rid of the employee education, you kind of minimize it down from a, you know, perception of the millennials aren't going to want to sit through these long-winded, you know, hour and a half presentations with a stack of paper, but it's going to be the same access to do online.
How are people buying the other 95% that don't buy it online? What's their process for buying it? And as that 5% increases, who loses? I mean, which intermediary sort of will lose business if that happens?
So you know, the far majority, I would say, in the under 100, maybe even under 300 space, really aren't using technology platforms to purchase their insurance for the employees. It's still a paper environment, whether it's a handout, an application. It's the same thing from an onboarding perspective. You know, if I got hired by a job today, you know, some employers using a whole onboarding tool where they fill out the information on online platforms. I put my name in once, my social security, my address, and it spits into all the I-9s and the W-4 forms and, you know, all the stuff that my employer wants, right? And so I'm not having to redo it. I can sign electronically, hit the button, and that's before I get hired. So I go to work day one and I'm ready to go. But the far majority of people are still in that paper environment. So you're going to see, I think, a shift where there's been, I was talking to someone earlier today, they brought up the word Zenefits. And Zenefits, for those of you who don't know, is basically an HR management tool that really was a big disruptor in the insurance business because they brought technology down to small companies. Their system was they really didn't do a good job because they're not insurance consultants or brokers. I like the word consultants. So they weren't able to give the insurance guidance. That's where I think they fell a little bit short. But what they did is they really required people to pick up their game from a technology standpoint. So there are technology options down to the small employers today's environment. It's not connected to the carriers the way it is in the big environment because the carriers aren't ready for those data feeds. However, it simplifies the process. You're getting clean data. So there's solutions down market that have come and will continue to expand and get better. Yes.
It doesn't take a lot of technical knowledge to buy clothing, books, hotel rooms, to get into something like medical and health insurance. That's a little more complex when it comes to terms,
yeah,
terminology, and is it possible to make it more like consumer?
Yeah, it really boils down to just how things have been done in the past as opposed to how things are going to be done in the future. So for example, there's a company out there called Jellyvision that builds employee engagement sites. So for example, they work with Target, Walmart, Costco, for example, and literally the employee goes through video set of questions. So for example, right now, using your PBM, if for example you have a pharmacy benefit management, you're self-insured, right? 25% to 30% of your actual spend in your medical plan is coming from your RX. Well, we were just at our national convention, and that number in the next couple of years, within the next 3 years, is going to go to 45. And you know what? It's even going to go further in the next, by 2020, it's probably going to be closer to 50%. Because what's happening is, as we are aging and graying, the doctors are prescribing more and more and more medications. Your RX spend is going to go up significantly to the point where it might be 50% of your medical spend. So the engagement on a annual basis of the employee actually going to the doctor is actually decreasing, whereas your RX spend is going up. So that's where engaging the employee, asking them questions, right, and engaging them as a consumer, it really creates price transparency and greater awareness and engagement, and equals control, which may equals demand for choice. Because they might not be going to the doctor as much as they used to. You're using things like Teladoc, using things like concierge medicine, for example, where they're going to the doctor less, but the prescriptions are going up. So utilization and the actual cost is going up, but the actual engagement going to the doctor is going down, so your RX is going up. So the engagement of actually using medical providers, I think over the long haul, will go down, but your prescription dollar cost is going up significantly. Yes, sir?
So I can't think from an HR, but from a user, I'm trying to figure out how it's going to simplify my ability to make a decision. I think of car insurance.
Yeah.
I can choose how much of the premium is going to be deductible, how much is going to be liability. Each one of those is priced separately. Do you think health insurance is going to go to that? Or we can say, we want a certain deductible on our prescription, and it'll be this much, or we can go higher deductible?
That's exactly it. And that's the direction using, instead of, hang on, hopefully it's
right now we just get a single amount.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can choose three or four plans to get a premium.
I think that it's going to move towards this.
All right. I think Michael did a good job of creating consumerism after the decision making. I think to go back to your question, there's some decision making tools where it's like a questionnaire in the beginning where an employee can put their information. It's going to ask them what they use the insurance for, how many doctor visits they go as a family, what type of doctors, medications, things like that. There's also going to be on the platform the short video. So what is an HSA plan or health savings account? What is a narrow network or ACO network? There's going to be short videos that are going to give them some explanation. There's going to be details for the people that want to read about it as well. And then there's going to be call center. So people can pick up the phone and talk to a live person. There's going to be chat as well, capabilities where they can chat with an individual and ask their questions. You know, for someone that says, I'm pretty close to making my decision, I don't want to get on a long-winded conversation, but these call centers are going to be licensed insurance experts that aren't going to be commission driven. So not trying to push product, they're trying to drive education so they can make informed decisions. Now, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I can't speak on everyone, but they're actually located here in the United States. I will tell you that the one thing about the insurance industry as a whole is it's pretty resilient. So things are going to continue to get better and expand. I think the one thing we fail as an industry is transparency. You talked about how does someone make a decision like that? Even in today's environment, you're relying on your employer to pick the one or two plans, and then you got to pick it, but you really don't know how to use it. And then when you actually go and use it, doesn't work the way. There's some employee advocacy programs out there, some companies out there that drive it. But I think it's only going to expand and get better. It has to in the industry. So it's bringing all that to one side for the employees to choose from.
Yes, sir.
We're already starting to see the 401k market change to the same environment where in the past, you know, we'd go out to a presentation and everyone would have to turn their forms into the HR department, fax them over to our office, and we'd send them up. We're about to do a 401k enrollment with Vanguard. And so basically, we'll do the enrollment, but then everyone has to go online and pick their funds. So how do they pick their funds? Well, they go through a risk profile questionnaire, and that leads someone to say, I need to have X percent fixed income and X percent in stocks. And then you build your plan.
Yeah.
If you don't want to build your plan, you have a default option, one of those target date funds. So one of my questions is, in the past, if someone wanted to enroll in the plan, they could turn their forms in, put 100% money market. I'd come back out and do a review meeting a year later, stock market's up 30%, and they were sitting in cash for the year. So the new plans, when the client signs up and they don't pick a fund, they're automatically defaulted into the target date fund based upon their age. How does this work if someone is given this money to go sign up for benefits and they don't go online?
Great question. So I would consider that kind of a passive enrollment. So for example, if you've got 500 employees, what you would do is you would default everyone into, you know, just from, you know, my kind of my CFO brain is you're going to default them into the plan that's going to cost the not only the employee the least amount of money, but also the employer the least amount of money. So that might be, for example, the high deductible medical plan, right? And I like your use of the word risk profile, because I think that's the best description that is going to create, our friend in the back there said, customization of your plan. Because we're all about customization now. When you go to the car dealer, Henry Ford said you can have, you know, you can have one car as long as it's black. Okay, well, that doesn't work anymore, because people can go on eBay and order your Mac in what, 4 different colors, right? Is yours pink, right? So, so really, customization is the wave of the future, and yeah, and different strokes for different folks. HMO, high deductible, PPO, but not only within that high deductible, there might be 3 different options. There might be a $3,000, $6,000, $10,000 deductible, because you're okay, because now with the ACA, you have to have health insurance, but you might have a $10,000 deductible because Jason might have $30,000 in his HSA, so he's okay with that risk. Question, sir.
Well, I think the issues that I've seen a lot with even the health insurance benefit just from the employee and the employer standpoint. For example, I just had a huge conversation with my employee, the fact that, you know, when, you know, so this time around when we rolled out our benefits, we basically tried to do, like with Blue Cross Blue Shield, you have 3 different networks with 3 different plans with 3 different deductibles. At that point, as much as we're trying to give them options, there's the lack of education of, even from the insurance side, what is a network, what is that covering, what type of doctor is covering under specific networks. So what happened is that this employee happens to choose a specific network that she doesn't have a doctor, and then she's got it. And then they did a surgery, and then just got a bill for $100,000 for, you know, for a surgery that was like a network. So,
yeah.
You know, for me, I think from the standpoint is, I think it takes both sides, because I think there's a lack of education even from the provider standpoint, trying to give more transparency. Okay, if you choose this doctor, you should be in this network. If you choose this doctor, you have to be in this network. Nobody knows, you know, and then the concept of network of doctors is a fluid concept at that point. You got doctors coming in and out of the plan. I mean, it just makes it at the point becomes so ridiculous trying to figure out, okay, I'm just gonna roll the dice and order, you know, and put something, and hopefully if I go to the doctor, it's covered at that point. You know, so I'm just trying to kind of figure out how do you bridge that gap, because you know, for me, is the lack of education from that standpoint is makes this whole concept of choice much more difficult at that point.
It does, and that's, I mean, that's where employee engagement is really important, and that's where, you know, just because the two of you have State Farm doesn't mean you have the same State Farm coverage. You know, just because you have Blue Cross Blue Shield doesn't necessarily mean you have the same Blue Cross Blue Shield, meaning one has a bigger network, one has a smaller network. And even in, for example, with HMO networks with Blue Cross, there's 4 different HMO networks that Blue Cross might have. There's 4 different PPO networks. And so if you select the wrong network, you're going to run into a situation like your staff member ran into. And so by using an online benefit and online engagement, using the risk questionnaire and using the risk profile, that helps bridge that gap.
I think we got to stop coddling the employees. And in that scenario, I think just more education needs to be done. Access to the information, whether it's through call centers, through to live chat, through whatever it may be, is you got to give the tools for those employees to make those decisions. But if that employee doesn't reach out and take ownership, that's not that there's some point that you can't be responsible for that anymore. That's an unfortunate situation. That's a very costly, you know, change. But, you know, just like today, you go in and I've got employers that say, well, we can't do technology because not everyone has a computer at home. And then you ask the question, how many people have a Facebook account? I personally don't, but I guarantee you that 99% of the employees do. And if they don't at Facebook, they have something else. So they have access to technology, smartphones, put, you know, get some computers in the, you know, kiosks in the office. I mean, there's ways to get around it, but you can't just today decide I don't want to do it and implement it tomorrow. There's got to be a big transition curve. It's got to be the proper education, planting the seeds for employees. They're not going to retain a whole lot of information in one meeting. So even doing, you know, kind of series, you know, lunch and learns, things like that. So.